الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Today inshallah ta'ala the reflection that we're going to have is going to be on أسباب زيادة الإيمان. أسباب زيادة الإيمان. The things that cause the iman to increase. The things that increase the iman. And also the things that reduce the iman, we will speak about it as well, inshallah ta'ala. First of all, before we go into the things that cause the iman to increase and the things that cause the iman to reduce, let's first talk about ahmiyatul iman, the importance of iman, wa'idami sha'nihi, and how great it is, and the benefits that are in iman. Ikhwani and akhawati, my brothers and sisters, a person will not attain success, not in this world nor in the hereafter, unless he comes with iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. Verily, success is for the believers. Success is for the believers. So the person's success is connected to the person's iman. And the success we're talking about is in this world. The true success person, the person who's truly successful is the person who's come with iman. It's not the person who has so much money in his account. It's not the one who has so many children. But it's the person who's come with iman. And every time your iman increases, the more your success increases. It is through iman that a person will be allowed to see Allah the Day of Judgment. And what is a greater success than that? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in a hadith that reached haddu tawatur. This hadith reached multitude narration. More than 30 companions narrated this from the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, which is innakum satarawna rabbakum, that you will all see Allah the Day of Judgment. Kama tarawna al-qamara, the way that you see the moon when it's full, the full moon, when the moon is on the 13th, how it's full. لا تضامون في رؤيتي, there's nothing in between you and seeing it. You will see Allah تبارك وتعالى. And this is تشبيه الرؤية بالرؤية لا تشبيه المرئي بالمرئي. It's comparing the looking to the look. It is not comparing what is being looked at to what is being looked at. It's not comparing Allah to the moon, but it's comparing the look to the look. The same way that you will see the moon, nothing between you and the moon, when the moon is full, is the same way that the person will see Allah the Day of Judgment. But this is, as Ibn Taymiyyah mentions in Islamiyah, he says, وَالْمُؤْمِنُونَ يَرَوْنَ حَقَّ رَبَّهُمْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ بِغَيْرِ كَيْفٍ يَنْزِلُونَ. المؤمنون, the believers are the one, يَرَوْنَ رَبَّهُمْ. It's the believers who will see Allah. This characteristics of iman is what allows you to see Allah, the Day of Judgment. And there's nothing greater than seeing Allah, the Creator, the Sustainer, the Provider, the one you've been worshipping all your life. It's even greater than Jannah. Allah says in the Quran, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُ الْحُسْنَى وَزِيَادَةً. Those who have come with excellency, they were righteous, they were noble. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he says, for them is what? لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُ الْحُسْنَى. For them is husna. Husna here means good. And the husna here means Jannah. For them is what? Jannah. The people who come with ihsan, for them is Jannah. Then Allah says, وَزِيَادَةً. وَزِيَادَةً here is what? It's more than Jannah now. It's an additional thing. What is it? رُؤْيَةُ اللَّهِ, seeing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Seeing Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is what the believers are given. And it's something Allah doesn't allow the disbelievers to attain. كَلَّا إِنَّهُمْ عَنْ رَبِّهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَمَحْجُوبُونَ. That the disbelievers, between them and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is a veil. They won't be seeing their Lord, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And then this is the fawa'id, the benefits of iman. Believing in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Also, the benefits that iman has is that it protects the person from the hellfire, and it allows the person to enter Jannah. If you look at the hellfire, when Allah talks about it, He says, "U'iddat lil kafirin," that the hellfire was prepared for who? It's prepared for the disbelievers, is where the disbelievers will finally enter. Whereas Jannah, the believers are going to enter Jannah. Even the believer who goes to the hellfire will finally come out of it and he will enter Jannah, because that's where Allah made for him. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said in the Hadith al-Qudsi that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will say, "Akhriju minan nari," take out of the hellfire, "Man qala la ilaha illallah," the one that says that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, "وَكَانَ فِي قَلْبِهِ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ مَا يَزِرُ ذَرَّةٌ," and in his heart is the mustard seed of belief. He's going to stay in the hellfire, he's going to burn in the hellfire for a period of time. But what is it that will take him out of the hellfire? Al-Iman. Even though it's small, it will still take him out of the hellfire. The benefits that Iman has, my beloved brothers and sisters, is also, if you're looking for tranquility, if you want to be a person who doesn't have depression, anxieties, Iman is what gives a person tuma'nina, sakina, tranquility. Allah says in the Quran, "Alladhina amanu wa tatma'innu qulubuhum bi dhikrillah." Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub. Allah says in this ayah, "Alladhina amanu," those who believe in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, "wa tatma'innu qulubuhum bi dhikrillah," and in the remembrance of Allah does their hearts find tranquility. "Ala bi dhikrillahi tatma'innul qulub," because it's through the remembrance of Allah does the heart find tranquility. In the beginning of the ayah, what did he say? "Alladhina amanu," those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's the believers who are going to find tranquility in their heart. Ya ikhwa, iman is the greatest blessing Allah has bestowed upon us. You have to ponder here. Abu Talib, the Prophet's uncle, who protected Islam, defended this religion, Allah didn't favor him with iman. But Allah favored you with iman. As Allah said in the Quran, "وَلَكِنْ كَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعِسْيَانِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الرَّاشِدُونَ." What was the beginning of the ayah? "يَا الَّذِي عَمَلُ إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَئٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَنْ تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ لَوْ يُطِيعُكُمْ فِي كَثِيرٍ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ لَعَنِتُّمْ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانَ وزينه في قلوبكم وكره إليكم الكفر والفسوق والعصيان أولئك هم الراشدون فضلا من الله ونعمة." فضل. What is it? It's a virtue from Allah. And it is also what? It's a ni'mah. It's a blessing. Allah is saying that to you, that I've adorned with you iman. And I've given you iman. This is what? It's a what? It's a fadl. In Surah Al-Hujurat, also the same surah, at the ending, what does Allah say? "يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا قُلْ لَا تَمُنُّوا عَلَيَّ إِسْلَامَكُمْ بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْ هَدَاكُمْ لِلْإِيمَانِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ إِذَنْ يَمُنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا قُلْ لَا تَمُنُّوا عَلَيَّ إِسْلَامَكُمْ بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمُنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْ هَدَاكُمْ لِلْإِيمَانِ." إذن it's a minnah, it's a virtue that Allah has given you iman. Abu Talib was a man who helped the Prophet. مع ذلك Islam was given to him. He said, "لَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ بِأَنَّ دِينَ مُحَمَّدٍ خَيْرُ الْبَرِيَّةِ دِينًا لَوْلَا الْمَلَامَةُ أَوْ حِذَارَ مُسَبَّتٍ لَوَجَدْتَنِي بِذَاكَ سَمْحًا مُبِينًا." He recognized what the Prophet was upon was the truth. The only reason that, or the only thing that prevented him from taking Islam was what? The forefathers and his parents and what they were upon. But Allah blessed you subhanahu wa ta'ala with iman. وَلِذَلِكَ the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's dua used to be, Allahumma, he used to say, "Oh Allah, man ahyaytahu minna," anyone from amongst us that you give life to, فَأَحْيِهِ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ, let him live upon Islam. وَمَن تَوَفَّيْتَهُ, and anyone from amongst us that you take his life away from him, minna, from amongst us, فَتَوَفَّهُ عَلَى الْإِيمَانِ. Then take his nafs from him upon what? Upon iman. The Prophet also used to say from his dua that he would make a lot is, اللهم زينا بزينة الإيمان. Oh Allah, adorn us and beautify us with iman. And وجعلنا, oh Allah, make us هداة مهتدين. Make us one who are guided and guide others. He also used to say, يا مقلب القلوب. Oh, the one who tosses and turns the people's hearts. ثبت قلبي على دينك, make my heart firm upon your religion. Then, those are some of the benefits that are in iman. Before I mention some of the things that we need to come with in order for our iman to increase. Anybody who wants success, brothers, anybody who wants to be prosperous in whatever they want to attain, whether it be religious matters or even worldly issues, you always require and you need to do two observations every time. Anything that you're doing in your life, if you want to be prosperous in it, if you want to be successful in it, you have to have two types of observation of everything. The first one is to look at, and especially the fact that we're focusing on right now is iman, right? You look at the things that will strengthen your iman, the things that will complete your iman, the things that will cause your iman to increase. And you also look at the things that will nurture your iman. That's one form of observation. You look at the positive thing. You learn about it. And the second one is, the second observation is you look at the things that will damage your iman. And that will harm your iman. And that can bring it corruption. It can reduce your iman. It can even fully get rid of your iman. Because if you don't know evil, will you be able to stay away from it? The poet, he said, عَرَفْتُ الشَّرَّ لَا لِلشَّرِّ وَلَكِنْ لِتَوَقِيهِ وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفِ الشَّرَّ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ يَقَعْ فِيهِ. He said, I came to know, عَرَفْتُ الشَّرَّ لَا لِلشَّرِّ. I came to know about the evil, not because it's evil in and within itself, not because I want it. But I came to know about the evil so I can stay away from it. Because the one who doesn't know evil, he will fall into it. And he got this from the statement of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, the hadith which is in Bukhari and Muslim, that Hudhayfa said, كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يدركني. He said that the people used to ask the Prophet about the good. They would come to him and they would ask him good. I, on the other hand, Hudhayfa, I would ask about the evil, مَخَافَةَ, fear that I might fall into it. So I'm scared of it. So the poet, he took it from that. So everybody who wants to attain what they want, they need to know the good and they need to know the evil in order to stay away from it. So when it comes to iman, you need to know the مُقَوِّمَات, أَسْبَابُ زِيَادَةِ iman, the things that will cause the iman to increase, the things that will nurture your iman. You need to study that. And you also need to study the opposite of that, which is the evil that can harm your iman, that can damage your iman. And once you do that, you truly will be able to strengthen your iman. Inshallah ta'ala, this sit and another sit, inshallah ta'ala, we will discuss these asbab ziyadat al-iman wa nuqsani. The first one, and I believe it's the aham, the greatest, the most important cause that will allow a person's iman to increase, وَيُقَوِّهِ, and it strengthens it, وَيُنَمِّهِ, and it also nurtures your iman, it is العلم النافع, beneficial knowledge. First thing is, if you want your iman to increase, is to come with beneficial knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he tells us that the Prophet was sent. Nabiullah Muhammad was what? He was sent. Nabiullah Muhammad was sent with two things. هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله. Ibn Jalil al-Tabari, Qurtubi, Al-Imam Muhammad Shukri al-Alusi, and others, they mentioned that what is meant by هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى, هدى here means العلم النافع, beneficial knowledge. ودين الحق means العمل الصالح. These are the two things Allah sent the Prophet with. The first is what? beneficial knowledge. He came to bring about beneficial knowledge. Because brothers and sisters, we as human beings, the two default characteristics that are in us is al-dhulm wal-jahl, ignorance and oppression. Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّا عَرَضْنَا الْأَمَانَةَ عَلَى السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَالْجِبَالِ فَأَبَيْنَا أَنْ يَحْمِلْنَهَا وَأَشْفَقَنَا مِنْهَا وَحَمَلَهَا الْإِنسَانِ إِنَّهُ أي الإنسان إِنَّهُ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا. Then the human is what? ظَلُوم and is what? جَهُول. These are the two characteristics that every one of us have. We have ظُلْم in us and we have jahl. This is the creation, how Allah created us. Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah says, Asrul insan is al-dhulm wal-jahl. That's the asr. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came, what was his aim and objective? It's to remove those two from you. That's the two he came to get rid of. He came to get rid of the ignorance that is in you and the oppression that is in you. Allah says in the Quran, يسبح لله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض الملك القدوس العزيز الحكيم هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he came, what is it that he came with? هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم يتلو عليهم آياته يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ الْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ. The Prophet came with tazkiyah and he came with what? Ilm. Tazkiyah is what gets rid of the jahl, the dhulm in you, and the ilm is what gets rid of the jahl that is in you. وَإِنْ كَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. When dhulm and jahl both are in you, that is what. That is dalalul mubin, clear misguidance. Are we all together? Well, لذلك, what did the Prophet say? He said, "Ana." Hadith Imam Ahmad narrated his Musnad that the Prophet said, "Ana da'watu akhi Ibrahim." Ana da'watu abi Ibrahim. Ana da'watu abi Ibrahim. I am the du'a of Ibrahim. What was the du'a of Ibrahim? Rabbana wab'ath fihim rasulan minhum yatlu alayhim ayatika. Wa yuzakihim. ويعلمهم الكتابة ويزكيهم إنك أنت العزيز الحكيم. صح؟ حفاظ, did I get that right? It's from the ayat which are متشابهات, صح؟ This ayah teaches Ibrahim is making a dua. What was the dua that he made? He said, oh Allah, send a prophet that will come with two things, التزكيه وال. Then brothers, one of the first things that increases knowledge is what? Increases iman, sorry, is what? What is it, brothers? Al-ilm al-nafi', beneficial knowledge. And the poet, he said, أطلب ولا تضجر من مطلب فآفة الطالب أن يضجر ألا ترى الماء بتكراره في الصخرة الصماء قد أثرى. Seek knowledge and don't give up. Try your best and strive to seek knowledge and learn and educate yourself and don't give up. Don't give up. فَآفَةُ الطَّالِبِ أَنْ يَطَّرَى. The greatest harm that a student of knowledge goes through is when he gives up. أَلَا تَرَى. Do you not see that the water, the continuation of the water and how much that water keeps going, فِي الصَّخْرَةِ الصَّمَّاءِ, a rock that's solid, قَدْ أَثَّرَى, it will affect it. If you look at a water and it keeps dropping on a rock, it will finally pierce through that rock. True or false? Huh? Would it not? The water will. The water is soft, right? But it will pierce through the. It will pierce through the rock. It will finally damage it. But when like it? After? After a long time. So the person has to know the serious, the greatness of seeking knowledge and attaining knowledge. Allah says in the Quran, يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ والذين أوتوا العلم درجة. Allah raises the ranks of the believers. The believers and the disbelievers, are they equal? They're not. The believers are greater than disbelievers. The lowest of the Muslims is better than the greatest of the disbelievers. But within the believers, are they all the same? Allah within them, who did He raise great? Who did He put higher? Allah put those of knowledge the greatest. The Prophet had the most knowledge. But within the people, the greatest of them are those who are the most knowledgeable one. But like Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, he says in the ayah, Allahu a'lamu haythu yaj'alu risalatahu. Allah knows where He's going to place His message. Didn't Allah choose who He was going to make a prophet? Were the prophets not chosen by Allah? The same way Allah chooses prophets, He chooses the people of knowledge. He what? He chooses the person who's going to gift him with this knowledge. It's not just everybody who's given to. Allah says in the Quran, أَمَّنْ هُوَ قَانِتٌ آنَاءَ اللَّيْلِ سَاجِدًا وَقَائِمًا يَحْذَرُ الْآخِرَةَ وَيَرْجُوا رَحْمَةَ رَبِّهِ قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الَّذِينَ يَعْلَمُونَ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ إِلَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. Are they equal? The one who knows and the one who doesn't know, are they equal? The answer is لا, they are not equal. Which one is better? The one who has knowledge. So knowledge is the first thing that increases a person's iman. If you want to attain knowledge, brothers, you need three characteristics. Three things, if you come with, you'll attain knowledge. The first one is an-niyatul khalisa, sincere intention. You're sincere, you're doing this for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we already mentioned, sincerity is what? Ikhlasuna lillahi saffil qalba min iradatin siwahu fahdhar ya fatin. That your heart is not connected to anybody, you're not doing this for anybody, only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the only objective and aim that you have in this issue. The second thing that allows a person to attain knowledge is himma aliyah. The person has high aspirations. The person has high aspiration. A person has high aspiration, they will attain great portion. Who's the king of the jungle? Who do they say is the king of the jungle? A lion doesn't eat dead corpse. The lion doesn't eat what's been killed by some other animal. The lion kills for himself. He's got his own aspiration. He does his own killing. He puts his own effort in. Exerts his own effort. So the person has to have high aspiration. ولذلك ابن الجوزي says in his kitab سيد الخاطر, he says كمال العقل علو الهمة والراضي بالدون دري. كمال العقل علو الهمة والراضي بالدون دري. Says كمال العقل. If a person's عقل is complete, if you know if a person is smart, he's a smart individual. This person is clever, mashallah. Is that he has high aspirations. And if you want to know if a person is dim-witted, he's mentally deficient, he has low aspirations. He's pleased with the bare minimal. Whereas a person whose aql is complete, he's always going for the highest things. So you have high aspirations. You set yourself a goal that's high and you work towards that. That's how you live your life. The third one is ma'rifatu tariq al-musil ilayhi. Knowing the path to attain knowledge. You have to know the third thing that you need as a person is what? You need to know the path to seek knowledge. What book do I start with? فَمَا حَوَى الْغَايَاتُ فِي أَلْفِ السَّنَةِ شَخْصُ الْفَخُذْ مِنْ كُلِّ فَنٍ أَحْسَنَ بِحِفْظِ مَتْنٍ جَامِعٍ لِلْرَاجِحِ تَأْخُذُهُ عَلَى مُفِيدٍ نَاصِحِ. No one can finish all knowledge. You're going to die and then you're still going to feel like you haven't done this. فَمَا حَوَى الْغَايَاتُ فِي أَلْفِ السَّنَةِ. If Allah give you 1,000 years, a million years to live, you'll still die wanting to study more, because knowledge will just never finish. So what do you do? If that's the case, this is what you do. فَمَا حَوَى الْغَايَاتُ فِي أَلْفِ السَّنَةِ شَخْصٌ فَخُذْ بِكُلِّ فَنٍ أَحْسَنَ. A particular person, take from them all sciences, a good portion of it, some good amount. How do you do that? بِحِفْظِ بَتِنِ جَامِعِ. Try to memorize a comprehensive text and take it to who? Somebody who's knowledgeable, who can teach you it. InshaAllah ta'ala, you might get somewhere. And it's always important to look at these three things. A lot of the people, they go Egypt, they go this country, they go that country, they go jami'a this, jami'a that, they study, they come back, but they suffer because they don't have a manhajiyah fi talib al-ilm. They don't have methodology to seek knowledge. They don't know what book to start with and what book to finish. So he's memorizing Bulugh al-Maram. A person comes up to you, says to you, "Oh, by the way, I don't think you should memorize Bulugh al-Maram." "And what should I memorize?" "Memorize Kitab al-Muharrar ibn Abdul Hadi." Okay, you put Bulugh al-Maram aside, then you go to al-Muharrar ibn Abdul Hadi. Another one comes up to you, says to you, "Akhi, I personally think that you shouldn't memorize the Muharrar." "And what should I memorize?" "Memorize al-Multaqa." So the person, 3-4 years, he might be struggling from one book to another because every time somebody's coming to him and advising him what to study, what not to study, and he's destroying his methodology of what to seek. So these three, if a person gets a niyatul khalisa, sincere intention, and then the second one is that the person has high aspiration, and then the third thing is that the person knows what methodology to take to seek knowledge, then the person will attain some knowledge. I can never promise you that you will attain all of knowledge, because knowledge cannot all be attained. But inshallah ta'ala, knowledge will feel sorry for you and give you something. Huh? After a period of time, when you've come with all of this and you've exerted everything you had, the knowledge might feel sorry for you and give you something in return. And that's the reality. So the first thing, brothers, that increases a person's iman is learning, educating yourself. Are we all together? لذلك, you know the famous hadith Ahmad narrated in his Musnad, Ashab al-Sunnah also narrated in hadith Abi Darda رضي الله تعالى عنه, that the Prophet said, من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له طريقا إلى الجنة. Anybody who treads on a path, and when he treads on this path, he does it because he wants to attain knowledge. That's his objective, that's his aim. He wants to gain knowledge. Allah will, as he has taken that path to seek knowledge, Allah is going to give him a path to Jannah. Al-Jaza'u min jins al-amal. But here I'm going to mention two points, and I'm going to conclude with that inshaAllah ta'ala, which is what knowledge should a person do in order for the iman to increase. I'm going to only mention two. The first one is al-ilmu billah, knowledge of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Learning Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, learning Allah's names, learning Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's what? Characteristics and attributes. Anybody who studies Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's iman increases. The more you learn Allah, the more your iman increases. Look what Allah said in the Quran, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. The reason why I read it like that is because in the Arabic language, there's the qa'idah, which is that the maf'ul is always after the what? Yeah? Huh? It's before the maf'ul. Which one's first? Is the fa'il first, or the maf'ul first, or the fa'il first? Yeah? The fi'l comes first, and then after that, the English is an SVO language, right? Fi'l, fa'il, alay. In this ayah, what happened? Which one came first, the maf'ul or the fa'il? Huh? Did the object come first, or did the subject come first? Huh? Huh? Which one came first? The object came first. The maf'ul came first. صح? That's why we say, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ. This shows something very powerful in the language, which is the qa'idah, which is تَأْخِيرُ مَا حَقُّهُ التَّقْدِيمُ تَقْدِيمُ مَا حَقُّهُ التَّأْخِيرُ يُفِيدُ الْحَصْرُ. If you put something forward that deserves to be put after, if you put it, bring it forward, in the Arabic language there's something called exclusivity. What does hasr mean? It means إثبات الحكم للمذكور ونفي عن بعده. Is that you're affirming the ruling for this particular issue and you're negating it from everything else. صح? So in other words, no one fears Allah تبارك وتعالى except the scholars. That's the meaning that comes out of the verse. That the only ones who fear Allah the way He deserves to be feared. Why have they attained that, and how did they attain the people of knowledge to be the ones that fear Allah تبارك وتعالى? As the people of knowledge say, من كان بالله أعرف. Anyone who knows Allah the most, كَانَ بِاللَّهِ أَخْشَىٰ فَمَا كَانَ مِنْهُ أَخْوَفُ. Or that person is more fearing of Allah تبارك وتعالى. The more you know him, the more you fear him. صحيح? If somebody just came from Somalia today, he landed, first day in London, never been here before, and he lands in London, and somebody gives him a car. Okay, I'm not insinuating that a person gives a car to a Somali who just landed from Somalia. But you give him a car and you say to him, drive. When you see that yellow box on the A406 or the dual carriageway, what do you know that means? That yellow box. It's a camera. You know this is a camera. You know when you get to that camera, what do? You slow down, right? He's just comfortable. Does he know what that means? What is he going to do? He's just going to carry on the speed that he's driving at. But you know, ouch. Point. The letter that's going to come through the post and the consequence they have to bear. True or false? So then your knowledge is more, so your fear in this situation is more. Sah? وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْعَلَىٰ. The one who knows Allah is like that. The more a person knows Allah, and the more he has knowledge of Him, the more that person is conscious of Him. And the more he's aware of Him. The Prophet said in a hadith, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ Allah has 99 asman. Allah has how many names? That we know of. There are more than that. 99 names. مِئَةً إِلَّا وَاحِدًا مَنْ أَحْصَاهَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. What does it mean, مَنْ أَحْصَاهَا دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ? Huh? Okay, مَنْ أَحْفَظَهَا. Anyone who memorized it. Hey, what else? Huh?
Live their life in accordance with it.
They live their life in accordance with it. That's it. It means to know it, memorize it, and live by it. So you know Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. You study each name. You stand over each name. Look at our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. When the ayah came down, قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِي إِلَى اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ يَسْمَعُ تَحَاوُرَكُمَا. إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ بَصِيرٌ. When this ayah came down, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said this following. She said, Alhamdulillahi alladhi, praises to Allah. Which one? Wasi'a sam'uhu. His hearing is vast. لقد جاءت المجادلة. The woman who was complaining had come. إلى النبي, she came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأنا في ناحية البيت. I was in the corner of the house. I was in the house at that particular time when the woman came into the Prophet ﷺ. She came to the Prophet and she was complaining about her husband. I was there. تَشْكُو زَوْجَهَا وَمَا أَسْمَعُ مَا تَقُولُ. I, Aisha, could not hear what she was saying. I was in the room on the corner. You have to remember those houses were not like these walls. Could hear everything. Aisha said, I can't hear it. I couldn't hear it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from high above, what did he say? قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ. Allah heard. Allah heard that complaint of that woman to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. It increases your knowledge of how Allah can hear everything that you're saying, you're doing. And it makes you become very vigilant in what you're doing. You ponder on the word, إِنَّ اللَّهَ سَمِيعٌ. Allah can hear everything I'm doing. بَصِير, He sees it. It makes you vigilant. The Prophet ﷺ said to the companions, أَرْبِعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Be kind and tenderness towards yourselves. فَإِنَّكُمْ لَا تَدْعُونَ أَصَمًّا وَلَا غَائِبًا. You're not calling onto one that is absent or one that is deaf who can't hear. إِنَّمَا تَدْعُونَ سَمِيعًا بَصِيرًا. You're calling onto one that can hear and one that can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, if somebody sat down and just pondered over this characteristics of Allah, Sami' and Basir, and they implemented it, would they do the things that some people do in private? Would you speak the way that you spoke if you pondered over how Allah tabarak wa ta'ala can see and hear everything that you're doing and is aware of it? They wouldn't. The person would be very scared and would be very vigilant. If two people speak to you today, you can't hear both of them. Two people speak at the same time. You're not able to hear both of them at the same time. Allah says in the Quran, مَا جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لِرَجُلٍ مِنْ قَلْبَيْنِ فِي جَوْفِ. Allah did not place in your heart two. You can only ponder on one over the other. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, all of the people who are speaking one time, you can hear every one of them. In all different languages. One time. He gives each and every one of them what they ask for. It doesn't reduce his what? It doesn't reduce his treasures and what he has, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He can hear all of that. No voice mixes up with another. If you really ponder over that, then it really what? It really makes you concerned. وَلِذَلِكَ brothers, what is the greatest ayah, أَعْظَمُ آيَةٍ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ, the greatest ayah in the Qur'an? Yeah? Ayat al-Kursi is the greatest ayah in the Qur'an, right? Is it the longest ayah in the Qur'an? What's the longest ayah? Ayat al-Dain, right? Yeah? Ayat al-Dain is longer. Which one has more huruf, more letters? Ayat al-Kursi or Ayat al-Dain? Which of the two has more letters? Huh? Which one? Huh? Ayat al-Dain has more letters. It's longer. You just said it's longer. And Ayat al-Kursi has less letters. But the Prophet ﷺ said to us in the hadith, لا أقول ألف لا ميم حرف ولكن ألف حرف ولام حرف وميم. So which one has more letters? How is Ayat al-Kursi still better than it if it's got more letters? Because it talks about Allah's names and attributes. Allah's name in Ayat al-Kursi and Allah's subhanahu wa ta'ala's name in Ayat al-Kursi has been mentioned 21 times. 21 times Allah's name or a pronoun that goes back to him has been mentioned 21 times. There's no ayah in the Quran like that. And the qa'idah to Ahli Sunnah wal Jama'ah is Allah's names are what? أعلام باعتبار دلالتها على الذات وأوصاف باعتبار دلالتها على المعاني. Every name of Allah has a characteristics that are in it. I don't want to, inshallah ta'ala, lengthen the reflection today. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.